So, for rain, it's so the rain is the material cause, and water is. Oh wait, never mind. So rain is the material cause, and if the efficient cause for rain is the cooling of moisture and condensation. The material cause of a house is bricks, and the efficient cause is the agent is the bricklayer and the builder.
Okay. Do you have it? No. Anybody else? Okay, Shrista, you can read yours now.
So the assignment was give practical examples of the material and efficient cause. So the first example is a table. So the material cause for the table is wood. The formal cause is the blueprint. The efficient cause of the table is the carpenter and the designer, the architect. The final cause is to be used for sitting, eating, working, and other things that you do with the table. And then gave an example of an office building. The material cause for the office building is bricks, cement, wood, and other construction materials. The formal cause is the blueprint of the building. The efficient cause is the architect, the construction worker, the carpenter, the plumber, etc. And the final cause is to be used for office work. And then the Harry Potter novel series. The material cause is paper and pencil. The formal cause is the written draft. The efficient cause is J.K. Rowling, or the author of the novel. And the final cause is to be enjoyed or to be read, like a recreational activity. And then I did the David, which is a statue. So the material cause is marble. The formal cause is the planning and sketches. The efficient cause is sculptor Michelangelo. And the final cause is for viewing or to honor David. And then I did company Amazon. The material cause is the code script and the inventory. The formal cause is the planning, brainstorming, the idea of the company. And the efficient cause is the CEO, Jeff Bezos. The final cause is to be used for ordering products and other such things. And then I also did the company Uber. So the material cause is the code script and the cars which they use. The formal cause is planning and brainstorming. The efficient cause is Travis Kalanick. He was the CEO and the founder. The final cause is to be used as a service to go to different places. And then a tree. The material cause is the seed. The formal cause is Krishna's design. The efficient cause is water, sun, and nutrients from the soil. And the final cause is to produce oxygen and to thrive.
Okay, that's pretty good. So you see that Krishna is the ultimate cause of everything, right? He's the cause of all causes. So Aristotle, when he made these four principles of cause and effect, he did it in a material sense. In other words, he did not believe that there's a God that's the cause of all causes. So he just defined material causes and material effects, but he's a very intelligent man. He was a very intelligent man, so he gave this, four elements of causality. There's the material cause, the formal cause, the efficient cause, and the final cause. However, we know that the efficient cause of everything is Krishna, and the material cause is Maya or matter, right? So your body is made of earth, water, fire, air, ether, mind, intelligence, and false ego. That is, and so you could say that your mother is the material cause of your body, and your father is the efficient cause of your body, because he provides the seed that fructifies in the body of the mother, and the mother provides the material elements of the body, and therefore a child is born. So it looks like the child was born out of the body of the mother. Correct, but only as the material cause. But the efficient cause was the seed that was planted by the father. So, therefore, like for example, a mother scorpion walks into a rice field, which usually is filled with water, and plants are growing in the water. Rice plants are growing in the water. But nobody sees that. It happens at night, late at night. But what people see is baby scorpions coming out of the rice field maybe a month or two later. Now, why did the mother scorpion lay the eggs in the rice field? Because there's sun that heats up the rice field every day, and there's some fermentation of the water that takes place in the water. Whenever there's water and plant material in contact, there will be some kind of fermentation with heat. So that protects the eggs of the baby scorpions that have not hatched yet, but it helps them stay warm. It helps them eventually to grow and develop, and then all of a sudden, the baby scorpion cracks the egg, comes out, and the farmer sees scorpions coming out of the rice field. He says, aha, now I understand. Scorpions come from rice. Is that true? Huh? Is that true, Rhea? But it looks like that, right? So, because the farmer didn't see that the mother scorpion went into the rice field late at night, nobody saw it, and laid the eggs. And during the day for months, nobody saw the eggs. They were tiny things, but they actually grew in the rice field because of the warmth and the protection. And eventually, the scorpion hatches and comes out. So there's an efficient cause and there's a material cause. Modern scientists, they only see the material cause. They only consider the material cause of things. So they believe everything comes from matter. Is that true? Let's see, how do you pronounce your name again? Samarth. Is that true? Everything comes from matter? No. No. That's not true, but that's the way they see things. And they think that the mind also comes from matter. Is that true? No. The brain comes from matter, but not the mind. There's a difference between the mind and the brain. Of course, scientists don't say that. They think that they're the same thing, but there's a difference. The mind is very subtle. The brain is a gross thing. You can map the brain, you know. This is the front part of the brain, this is the right side of the brain, left side of the brain. You know, they dissect a human being, and they look at the brain and they try and figure out which part of the brain controls what, which function of the body, right? So in the 1930s, they found out that there are electrical impulses connecting the brain to the body, but they didn't know what those impulses were doing. But by continuing their research, they found out that certain impulses control emotions, certain impulses control let's say, pain and so forth. So therefore, they think everything starts from matter, and then and the brain is developed at a certain point of evolution of matter, and that these electrical impulses between the brain and the body parts, they've learned to understand them to a certain extent, right? And they know from which part of the brain certain types of electrical impulses go to different parts of the body and control different things. So this is actually a wrong concept, that everything starts from Krishna, of course, and we are part and parcel of Krishna as jiva souls. And when the jiva soul is planted, or that seed of the jiva is planted by the father into the mother's body, and the mother provides the material elements so that the body around the jiva can grow and eventually develops, a head and arms and legs and bodily parts and organs, very complicated, and then it's pushed out and it's a little baby. So the efficient cause is the father, the material cause is the mother. And in the body of the baby, there's a mind or a brain. But actually, the brain is simply like a muscle, but the brain is seems to be functioning on itself, but actually there's a subtle mind behind it. And you can't see the mind. You can see the brain, you can't see the mind, right? Because it's more subtle matter. Just like you can't see electromagnetic waves, but they're flying through this room right now. If you have a cell phone or a telephone, you can receive those waves, and those waves are carrying information. Can you see them? No. Can you deny that they're here? No. You just take your cell phone out, and right away, you're getting all this information. How is it coming? There's no wires. There are no wires, right? It's coming through the air. And it's carrying information. Like, it's coming right now. I can't pick up what it's saying, right? But you get your cell phone or a radio or a television, it picks it up. And it translates it to you. It picks up those electrical waves, and it translates it so that you can understand it. Right? So this is what's going on between the mind and the body also. The brain is getting certain electrical impulses that it's sending to parts of the body, and it's controlling the movement of the body. So, but the brain did not develop. The brain is developed from matter, but the mind did not develop from matter. Matter developed from the mind, right? Just like Jeff Bezos developed Amazon. Company Amazon. Amazon didn't create Jeff Bezos. See? So the scientists have it wrong. They think everything comes from matter. No, it's not true. Everything comes from Krishna, and there's different levels of how it's coming. The jivas expand from Krishna, and then the jivas have this subtle body made of mind, intelligence, false ego, and a subtle body is full of desires and karma also from previous lives, and that's what creates the particular type of body you have. So Jeff Bezos created Amazon, and you created your body, or the type of body, based on your previous karma and your unfinished desires. So you get a particular type of nose, you get a particular type of ear, particular types of eyes and hair and so forth. It's all based on your previous karma and your unfinished material desires. See? It's not that matter created your body, and matter created your mind, and matter created your intelligence, and matter created this or that. It's the opposite. And this is not understood by scientists, because they think matter is the source of everything. So therefore, if you study their science, you'll never figure out what is the truth. You always see everything backwards. So they think the goal of life is sense gratification. That's not the goal of life. The goal of life is to attain liberation from birth and death by giving up selfish sense gratification and working for the sense gratification of Krishna. Completely opposite to what the scientists think. You see. So unless we understand this, we start believing what the scientists say. And they say, well, we have our proof. I mean, we make bridges, we make rockets, we make electrical generating plants, we make computers, we make cell phones. That proves that we know what we're doing. But does that make people happy? Not necessarily. I mean, now you see today, people are killing other people all the time, right? And the people are angry. And there's all kinds of political, divergence. There's Democrats and the Republicans, and there's this and there's that, and there's communists and there's jihadists. And so people haven't become more happy because the scientists make bridges and airplanes and rockets and cell phones. Right? In fact, if anything, they're getting more angry and more frustrated. Right? So because they have everything backwards, they're seeing things wrongly. And unless we can correct that, we will just follow like sheep. There's a saying that there's a phenomenon in nature. If one sheep jumps over a cliff, the other sheep will follow it. Right? So should we be like sheep? If one sheep commits suicide, should we all commit suicide? No. So we have to learn what the truth is. Otherwise, we'll just blindly follow the sheep. We'll blindly follow like sheep. And the scientists lead us to more and more frustration. And we just go along with it and become frustrated and eventually commit suicide. I mean, a lot of kids commit suicide today. In Sammamish and Issaquah, in the last 2-3 years, 5 kids have committed suicide. Kids, I mean, only like 14, 15-year-old kids. Have you heard about that? Huh? What? Yeah. So why would they do that? They're still young and they have their whole life in front of them. Well, because frustration. Why are they frustrated? Because they're looking for happiness in the wrong places. And they get frustrated and they want to commit suicide. So, therefore, I'm going to read something now. This is Srimad Bhagavatam, first canto, second chapter, verse 33. You can write this down. 1, 2, 33. 1, 2, 33. Srimad Bhagavatam, 1, canto 1, chapter 2, verse 33. And it says, the supersoul enters into the bodies of the created beings who are influenced by the modes of material nature and causes them to enjoy the effects of these modes by the subtle mind. You don't have to write that down, but this is going to be your homework. Okay. So, purport, Prabhupada says, there are 8,400,000 species of living beings, beginning from the highest intellectual being, Brahma, down to the insignificant ant, and all of them are enjoying the material world according to the desires of the subtle mind and gross material body. Don't put your fingers in your mouth. You have to wash your hands. You either go wash your hands in the fountain. Let me read that again. There are 8,400,000 species of living beings, beginning from the highest intellectual being, Brahma, down to the insignificant ant, and all of them are enjoying the material world according to the desires of the subtle mind and the gross material body. Now, here is one difference already. What does Darwin say? Where did everything start from in the origin of species? Samarth. No, he didn't talk about the Big Bang. There was no Big Bang theory in Darwin's time. Yeah, it's just that. Yeah, and he doesn't say how that single cell was created. So now let's compare what we just read. Let me read it again and listen carefully. You ready? You ready, Arush? I'm going to ask you to ask you a question now, right? Listen carefully, because Darwin says everything starts from a single cell, an amoeba, right? And here, I'm going to read this now. There are 8,400,000 species of living beings, beginning from the highest intellectual being, Brahma, down to the insignificant ant. And all of them are enjoying the material world according to the desires of the subtle mind and gross material body. So is there a difference between what Darwin says and what we just read? What's the difference? Highest intellectual being, down to the lowest. And what does Darwin say? Yeah, the lowest intellectual, and it goes up. You see, their whole idea is opposite to the truth. Now, if you were going to start, let's say you were Jeff Bezos, and you're going to start a company, right? Now, Jeff Bezos is already rich. He already has Amazon. But now he's going to start another company. Who would you hire first, the guy who cleans the toilet or the CEO? Why? Yes, much more intelligent than the guy who cleans the toilet, right? But the scientists say, no. The creation started with the guy that cleans the toilet. Not the most intelligent guy, Brahma. And then Brahma evolved from the guy that cleans the toilet. You see, that's stupid. It's completely opposite of what you would do, what any reasonable person would do. But this is what the scientists say. Okay, so now I'll read the next. The gross material body is based on the conditions of the subtle mind, and the senses are created according to the desire of the living being. And what do the scientists say? Okay. The scientists say that the mind is produced by matter. What does it... Well, let me read this again. Now, Rhea, you tell me what the difference is here. Okay? Scientists say the mind is produced by matter, right? And now I'm going to read this and you tell me the difference. The gross material body is based on the conditions of the subtle mind, and the senses are created according to the desire of the living being. So what's the difference? Scientists say everything comes from matter, from the body. What do we read? What did we read here? So the gross material body, meaning the body made of matter, is based on the conditions of the subtle mind. And the senses are created according to the desire of the living being. So the material, the gross material body of a person is based on the conditions of the subtle mind. So what do the scientists say? Right, and what does this say? Created by? from the... Well, ultimately, yeah, he's the cause of all causes. But the type of body you get is based on the subtle mind you have and the karma you have. So, again, what they're saying is opposite to what the truth is. You see? So if everything you learn is opposite, everything you learn by the scientists and the atheists, philosophers, is opposite of what the truth is, can you ever attain real happiness and love in life? What do you think, Rhea? If everything you're learning is opposite to the truth. You know, you'll never achieve real happiness or real love because everything you're learning is opposite to the truth. You see? This is why we read Srimad Bhagavatam, to know what the truth is. Other people think Bhagavatam's not important. What's true is what the scientists say. Right? Do they read Srimad Bhagavatam in the public schools? No, no way. They wouldn't. They'd say it's a waste of time. It's not science. But what they're doing is not science. You're saying what they're teaching is not real science. It's the opposite of the truth. It's like believing that scorpions come from rice fields. Is that true? No, it's not true. It may look like that because of incomplete knowledge, but it's not true. It may look like that because they see the scorpion, baby scorpions coming out of the field. They say, ah, it's born from rice. But if you studied it carefully, you see, no, it's not true. The mother scorpion, when no one was looking, went into the rice field and laid her eggs, right? That's the truth. So this says, the gross material body is based on the conditions of the subtle mind, and the senses are created according to the desire of the living being. The Lord as Paramatma helps the living being to get material happiness because the living being is helpless in all respects in obtaining what he desires. Now the scientists say, there's no super soul, there's no God, there's no, matter being produced by the mind of God. There's just matter. That's all there is. And everything else is made from matter. So you see, and basically they're saying, we're independent. Everything is in this world independent. There's no God behind everything. There's just science and reason and logic. But here it says, the Lord as Paramatma helps the living being to get material happiness because the living being is helpless in all respects in obtaining what he or she desires. So this idea that we are independent is actually wrong. We're completely dependent on Krishna, who's present in the heart as Paramatma. You see? Now, if you believe that you're independent and there's no God and no supreme authority or supreme intelligent person behind everything, it's just human beings and matter, then you are not actually a human being. You're an animal. Animals don't understand things, you say. Animals don't understand why they're suffering. Animals don't understand how things are working. All they understand is eating, sleeping, mating, and defending. So now we're going to hear something from a lecture at Prabhupada, which is very, very interesting. Okay, so your homework is you read this verse 1, 2, 33, and you explain all the mistakes that the scientists make about reality. Now I'm going to read something from Prabhupada, and it's an incredible verse. 1, 2, 33. So he says, O son of Prita, in this world there are two kinds of created beings. I'm sorry. Your homework is 1:32:33, but this verse that I'm reading, that Prabhupada's going to talk about, is Bhagavad Gita, 16th chapter, 6th verse. 16:6, write that down. And Krishna tells Arjuna, O son of Prita, meaning Arjuna, his mother's name was his mother's name is Prita. His name is Partha. O son of Prita, in this world there are two kinds of created beings. One is called the divine and the other is the demoniac. I have already explained to you at length the divine qualities. Now hear from me of the demoniac. So Krishna is saying there's two types of people in the world. There are divine people and there are demoniac people. Okay? Which one do you think are the scientists? Yes, most of them. There are a few that are somewhat divine, but now we're going to learn what this difference is between a divine person and a demoniac person. Prabhupada explains it here very carefully. Now, I was born a demoniac person, but by associating with devotees and learning from Prabhupada, I'm trying to be a divine person, right? So it doesn't, just because someone is born demoniac doesn't mean they're going to be a demon the rest of their life. It depends on who you associate with in life. If you associate with other demons, you remain a demon. If you associate with devotees, you have a great chance of becoming a devotee. It's not that because I'm born in a family that eats meat. Of course, my family believed in God, but they didn't practice their belief in God. But they believed that there is a God. They went to church, but they ate meat, and they drank wine and whiskey, and they gambled, and all these bad habits. So they were not really devotees at all, although they, on the surface, they said, we believe in God. Right? So that doesn't make them divine, because their practices in life were demoniac. So I was born in a demoniac family. Okay. So Krishna says, Prabhupada says, he reads this verse. It says that there are two types of people, demons and devotees. And now Prabhupada says, Bhagavan, Sri Krishna, is addressing Arjuna. Sometimes he addresses him as Bharata, the descendant of the Bharata dynasty. And sometimes he addresses him as Partha. And sometimes he addresses him as Dhananjaya, his friend. This time he addresses him as Partha. Partha means his mother's name was Prita. From Prita the word Partha comes. His mother happened to be Krishna's father's sister. What does that make him? That makes her his auntie, right? He's the auntie, sister of the father. So very intimately and friendly, he addresses him as Partha, my dear son of my auntie, right? That means we have got very intimate relationship. Not only we are friends, but we have got family relationships. So Krishna's speaking to Arjuna like this. So therefore, I am speaking to you about the truth. See, if you're talking to someone who's a close relative of yours, you're not going to lie to them. You're going to tell them the truth, right? Because you're intimate. And he says, and the truth is there are two classes of living beings in the world. There's the demons and there's the devotees. Now, it doesn't mean that because you're born in a demon family that you have to be a demon the rest of your life, you can't change. No. Because there's one thing that's not regulated by the law of karma. Write this down. One thing that is not regulated by the law of karma. One thing that is not regulated by the law of karma. What is it? Surrender to Krishna. You can be the worst person. You can have the worst karma in the world. Born in the worst family that does all sinful things. And you also were taught to do sinful things. But if you surrender to Krishna, and you're sincere about it, and you accept bona fide guru and follow instructions, you become a devotee. Because it's not regulated by the law of karma. If that was also regulated by the law of karma, it would be impossible for you to become a devotee. If you were born in a demon family, you'd have to be a demon the rest of your life. So the proof is, Vibhishan, the brother of Ravana, he's born in a Rakshasa body, but he, because the body came from his mom, father gave the seed, but mother's body was like a Rakshasi. So they looked like Rakshasas. Vibhishan looked like a Rakshasa, but actually he was a devotee. Right, because he surrendered to Lord Rama. Okay? So Prabhupada says, so in Vishnu Purana, there's also a reference to this context, to this verse in Bhagavad Gita, which says, the verse in Bhagavad Gita is, Dvo bhuta sargo loke smin, daiva asura evacha, daivo vistarasa prukta asuram partame srinu. And the verse in the Vishnu Purana says, Dvo bhuta sargo loke smin. The first line is the same in both verses. Daiva asura evacha. And the second verse, second line is the same. But the third verse is different. It says, Vishnu bhakto bhaved daiva asuras tad viparyaya. So you have two verses, one in Bhagavad Gita, 16:6, and you have Vishnu Purana. They basically say the same thing. So Prabhupada says, daiva means generally Vishnu bhakta. Daiva means transcendental. So Vishnu devotees, genuine Vishnu devotees, are transcendental. Right? That means they're not influenced by the modes of material nature. They never deviate from Krishna consciousness. Vishnu means the Supreme Lord who is all-pervasive. All-pervasive means he expands himself as Paramatma in the heart of every living entity. And also in every atom. Everywhere he is present. Krishna, the Supreme Lord, he is Vishnu also in his Paramatma feature. Krishna has got three features, Brahmeti, Paramatmeti, Bhagavaniti, Sabhyate. He is Brahman effulgence, he is Paramatma, and he is Bhagavan Krishna. So everything is coming from Krishna. Even Lord Vishnu comes from Krishna, Narayana comes from Vishnu, etc. And therefore, Krishna is the Paramatma. Krishna, the absolute truth, is known in three features or three angles of vision. One is Brahman, all-pervasive, meaning present everywhere. Sarvedam akilam jagat. So Brahman means his effulgence, bodily rays. Yasya prabha prabhavato jagadandakoti. So Prabhupada is giving references here to the Brahman effulgence that comes from Krishna. So it's in the Srimad Bhagavatam, and then it's in Brahma Samhita, 5th chapter, verse number 40. His prabha, his bodily rays. You may ask, what is that bodily rays? Or what are those bodily rays? You can see every day. Everyone has got bodily rays according to his quality. You see the sun. The sun has bodily rays, the sunshine. There is sun god within the sun globe. His name is Vivaswan. That is also mentioned in Bhagavad Gita. Imam Vivasvate Yogam Proktavan Aham Aviam. You don't have to write down all these things. Just listen right now. So exactly like that. Here, sun is an insignificant part, creation of the Lord, and the sun has got so much effulgence, bodily rays, that it is illuminating and heating the whole universe. You cannot deny it. So here's another point that the scientists have wrong. Actually, there's only one sun in the universe. That's the sun that we see. All the other stars are not suns. They're simply reflecting the light of the sun. Whereas the scientists think every one of those stars is also a sun. It's another thing, completely opposite the truth. So similarly, Krishna is present in everyone's heart. He's localized. This is impersonal expansion. Just like sunshine is impersonal expansion of the sun's rays. So similarly, Brahman effulgence is the impersonal expansion of Krishna's bodily rays. And the portion by which he is present everywhere, Andantarasta Paramanujantarastam, again he's quoting Brahma Samhita, 5th chapter, 35th verse. He is within this universe. He is within your heart, within my heart. He is within everything. Everything means even within the atom, Paramanu. That is his Paramatma feature. So he's present everywhere as Brahman, effulgence, and he's present everywhere as Paramatma. Both ways he's present everywhere. Right? The Brahman is the basis on which the whole material nature and the spiritual world is resting on. And Paramatma, in the material world, there's no need of Paramatma in the spiritual world because Krishna is there, right? And he has his Narayana expansions and so forth. But Paramatma in the material world is also present everywhere, in every atom and in the heart of every living entity. Okay. And the last and ultimate feature is Krishna's personal body, Satchitananda Vigraha, Ishwara Parama Krishna, Satchitananda Vigraha. So again, he's quoting Brahma Samhita 5.1. Vigraha means form. That form is not like ours. That form is Satchitananda. What's Sat mean, Riya, you know? Eternity. You know what Chit means? Samarth. Sat means eternity. Chit means. You know what chit means? No. Chit. Yes, knowledge. And then Ananda, what's Ananda mean? Yes. So Krishna's body is made of, his body means his vigraha, his form, is made of Sat, Chit, Ananda, vigraha, right? What's your body made of, Riya? Tell me what you have in your body. What do you? Bones, yeah, that's one thing. What else? Blood. Stool. Bowels, yeah. So, is there a difference in your body and Krishna's body? Yeah, big difference. Yeah. Is this your body, though? No, it's just a temporary body. You also have a soul in the body. And your soul does have a body also, just like Krishna has a body. What's your soul made of? Bones? Stool? Then what's it made of? You know what your spiritual body is made of? No, you don't know. What's Krishna's spiritual body? Samarth. Yes, you have a Satchitananda body, but it's not, it's qualitatively one with Krishna, but it's not the same quantitatively. Krishna's body is infinitely great, and our bodies are infinitely small. Right? But qualitatively, they're the same. Right? So right now, your material body is covering your soul, which has a spiritual body. Okay, but your material body was made according to what? We read it earlier. It's part of your, going to be part of your homework. What is your material body? Yes. Perfect. Yes. Very good. Let's see. So as long as we have material desires and we have karma, we get a particular type of body, right? That's not spiritual. But when we purify our karma and our material desires and replace them with spiritual desires, then we will see our spiritual body. Okay. So when this body, so our body is not eternal, and it says, that form is not like ours. In other words, the Satchitananda form of Krishna is not like our body, material body. That is Satchitananda, his body is Satchitananda. The body has also three features. Sat means eternal. So therefore, his body is distinct from our material body. Our material body is temporary. His body is eternal. Our body is not eternal within the history. When this body is created by father and mother, there is a date when it starts. You know, when was your date of starting this material body? Yes. May 5th? What year? Like 1930? 2005, right. And when did your body start? 2000 what? Seven, okay. So, our body has a date when it begins, and it'll have a date when it ends, right? Krishna's body doesn't have a date when it begins, and doesn't have a date when it ends. And your spiritual body is also like that, right? But right now we're thinking, I am this material body, so therefore it has a date in history when it begins, and a date in the future where it's going to end. And when this body is finished, annihilated, there's another date. So anything within the dates, that is history. Okay? But Krishna is not like that. He is anadi. Anadi means without beginning. You cannot estimate when Krishna's body began. Anadi. Adi. Again, adi. Beginning. He is the beginning of everyone. Anadi. He himself is anadi, has no beginning. Okay, we'll finish this thought, and then I'll give you exactly what your homework is going to be. I already said it, but I'll say it again. And then you'll have to do your homework for tomorrow. Right?
Thank you. just finish and switch it off.
Yeah.
Yashomati Nandana Brajabharanagara Gokularanjana Kana Yashomati Nandana Brajabharanagara Gokularanjana Kana Gopi Paranadana Madana Manohara Gopi Paranadana Madana Manohara Kaliya Damana Vidana Amala Harina Mamiya Vilasa Amala Harina Mamiya Vilasa Vipina Purandara Navina Nagara Bora Bamsi Badana Suvasa Prajajana Palana Surakulanasana Prajajana Palana Surakulanasana Nanda Godana Rakovala Govinda Madhava Navanita Taskara Govinda Madhava Navanita Taskara Sundara Nanda Gopala Jamuna Tata Chara Gopi Basanahara Rasa Rasika Kripa Moya Shri Radha Vallabha Vrindavana Natabara. Shri Radha Vallabha Vrindavana Natabara. Bhakti Vinoda Shayak. Yashomati Nandana Brajabharanagara Gokula Ranjana Kana. Jayo Radha Nila Madhav Radha Nila Madhav Radhe. Jayo Radha Nila Madhav Radha Nila Madhav Radhe. Jayo Lakshmi Narasimha, Jayo Lakshmi Narasimha, Jayo Lakshmi Narasimha, Jayo Lakshmi Narasimha. Jayo Sita Ram, Jayo Sita Ram, Jayo Sita Ram, Jayo Lakshman Hanuman. Jayo Jagannatha, Jayo Jagannatha, Jayo Baladeva, Jayo Subhadra. Jayo Gauranita, Jayo Gauranita, Jayo Gauranita, Jayo Gauranita. Jaya Jaya Prabhupada, 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 Jaya Jaya Prabhupada. Jaya Jaya Prabhupada, 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 Jaya Jaya Prabhupada. Jaya Jaya Gurudev, 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 Jaya Jaya Gurudev. Nitai Gaura Hari Bol, Hari Bol, Hari Bol, Nitai Gaura Hari Bol.
Everything material has a beginning and an end, But Krishna is anadi, without beginning and without end. So your body also has a beginning and an end, therefore it has a history. Right? But the soul, your soul that's in the body, doesn't have a beginning and it doesn't have an end, because you're part and parcel of Krishna. Most people don't understand this. If you understand this, what I just explained about history, the material nature, the manifest nature, has a beginning and end. Your body has a beginning and end, so you have a history. But Krishna is anadi. He doesn't have a beginning, and he doesn't have an end. And your soul, as part and parcel of Krishna, also does not have a beginning or an end. It's not part of history. Okay. You cannot estimate when Krishna's body began. He also is the beginning of everyone, but he himself is without beginning. Nobody can find out what is the date of his appearance. He is beyond history. But he is the beginning of everyone. Just like my father is the beginning of my body, father is the cause of the beginning of my body, or your body, everyone. So therefore he has no beginning, that he has no father. I'm talking about Krishna now. He has no beginning and he has no father, but he is the Supreme Father. That is the conception. Christian conception says God is the Supreme Father. That is a fact, because he is the beginning of everyone. Janmadaseyata. From him everything is coming. That's the first canto, first chapter, first verse of Srimad Bhagavatam. Janmadaseyata. Everything is coming from Krishna. Whatever has come into being, that is from Krishna. That is stated in Bhagavad Gita. Aham adir hi devanam. Bhagavad Gita, 10th chapter, 2nd verse. He says that he is the source of all the devas also. This Brahmanda is the creation of Brahma. He is called one of the demigods. So Krishna says, Aham adir hi devanam. I am the beginning of the devatas, or demigods. So if you study Krishna in this way, then you become daiva, or divine. So write down this word daiva, D-A-I-V-A. D-A-I-V-A. Daiva means divine. You write this down, Rhea, daiva, D-A-I-V-A. Daiva means divine. So, if you understand what Prabhupada just explained about Krishna, he is anadi, without beginning, without end, and everything is coming from him, you're coming from him, I'm coming from him, the material nature is coming from him, the Brahma Jyoti is coming from him, the Paramatma is coming from him. So if you understand this, then you become a divine person. You're no longer a demon. And if you don't understand it, you remain a what? Huh? What? Yes. Very good. Our Krishna consciousness movement is meant for educating everyone to become divine. That is the program. So what is the gain by becoming divine? That is described in the previous verse, 16:5. Daivi sampat vimokshaya. If you become divine and acquire the divine qualities, abhayam sattva samsudhi jnana yoga vivastiti. That is, we have discussed already. So if you become divine and there's no impediment to becoming divine, in other words, anyone can become divine, because why? Why can anyone become divine? Even the demons. Why? Shastra. Right. So it doesn't matter what your karma is. So there's no impediment, there's nothing to stop us from becoming divine. Simply have to practice Krishna consciousness. Just like anyone can become a high court judge, or anyone can become president of the United States. But you have to be qualified. If you qualify yourself, you can attain any position. Similarly, as it is said, to become daiva or divine, you have to qualify yourself to become divine. And how do you become divine, or how to become qualified? You develop divine qualities. So what are the divine qualities? That's explained in 16 verses 1 to 3. So your homework, second homework, is read chapter 16, Bhagavad Gita, verses 1 to 3, to learn what the divine, what is the benefit of becoming divine. You will develop those qualities. Chapter 16, verse 1 to 3. So it says, Abhayam sapasam satyasam sudhir jnana yoga vyastati, and so forth. It's a very nice verse. Okay, so now you have two homeworks. One is, you're going to read 1, 2, 33, Srimad Bhagavatam, first chapter, first canto, second chapter, verse 33, and tell and write down everything that the scientists get wrong. Right? So, they say everything began with a single cell amoeba, but actually everything began with Lord Brahma in the material creation. He's the most intelligent person. A single cell amoeba is not so intelligent. But by the way, a single cell amoeba is already a highly developed living entity. It's actually a complicated living entity, even though it's a single cell. And where that came from, nobody says. They say it all began with that, but they don't know where it came from. So the scientists don't know what they're talking about, basically. But they can make rocket ships, trains, cell phones, and things like that. So Ravana could make those things too, but he was defeated by Krishna. So just because you can make high-tech instruments doesn't mean you know everything. You know something. But unless you use those high-tech instruments in the service of Krishna, they become zero. Zero value. Okay. Hari Bol. All glories to Srila Prabhupada Ki Jai. So you have your homework now, right? And then you're going to read 16, 1 to 3. And learn what the divine qualities are. If you become divine by understanding Krishna is Satchitananda Vigraha, and Krishna is Anadi. If you understand those things, you become divine, a divine person. And then if you become a divine person, you develop divine qualities. So now you're going to read what those divine qualities are.